I am a value investor. I'm primarily in the long side, but we've been shorting for the 30 years that I've been in business. And the Tesla story and the narrative that has been spun around electrification of cars has actually created phenomenal long opportunities, single-digit PE stocks all around the world, which we're long. Now, we are following Tesla. I have experience myself with automotive manufacturing as an investor, but also as a director of a car company at one point. And I must say, the biggest issue with Tesla, if you just step away from it's a cult stock or technology, anything, there's one factory, Fremont, California, that made 400,000 cars under the capable ownership of GM and Toyota. Under 7 or 8 years of Tesla ownership, they've gotten up to maybe 100, 150,000, 200,000 cars. It doesn't matter. The max performance of that factory is 400,000. And frankly, they're doing it in tens right now. And the next factory they're talking about will take 3, let's say 5 years to build and to get up to speed at least. So you're basically running into a brick wall in terms of producing cars at 400,000 at the most. And so how can you justify $64 billion market cap, which is then basically the cult stock factor, which, you know, time is ticking on that one.
You've made one of the key cases against Tesla that we often hear. But let me ask you this. You said you're long a lot of automotive stocks that are trading, that have great opportunities because of electrification, et cetera. They're trading at single PEs. Why go long those and short Tesla at the same time? I mean, really double down. There's no hedging there.
Let me clarify. The internal combustion engine and the hybrid engines all need spark plugs. They all need components to make these cars work. This year, we're selling 93 million cars, less than a million is electric vehicle. There's a billion cars on the road, mostly internal combustion engine or hybrid. All of them need spark plugs, all of them need service, and there's a lot of companies in the disrupted areas, as they call it, that are going to have a long, long tail for decades, making a ton of money. And so they're trading at 4 or 5 times EBITDA, and you can buy those right now in the market. At such a discount.
But my question is, why do both? It really concentrates your position.
No, it's really, I mean, you go long something usually undervalued and misunderstood right now that's for real, that makes a lot of money. Mm-hmm. And on the other hand, you're short something that is a cult stock that a lot of people love to see succeed. And I must give them credit and the company a lot of credit for what they've done. Built good cars, they disrupted the industry. But now reality is weighing in. It has a negative working capital, it has $10 billion in debt, it can't seem to make money. It has its own retail outlets, it has its own charging stations. It is a model that has not produced, even with scale, any profitability. So that's the issue. I wish everybody there well, but we need to take positions, and this is a short
It hasn't gone to scale yet, so the verdict on profitability is still out, but your premise is that it will never get to scale, get to sufficient scale to see profitability?
It will get to scale if they do the right thing. They should really issue a ton of equity right now while the stock is at such a high valuation. And then people should be realistic. It simply takes 3 years, as Mr. Musk said as well, to build a new factory, say in Shanghai. Then it takes, a long time to get quality cars out the other end, as we've seen with the Fremont, California factory, which they've had for 8 years.
So you mentioned valuation. Again, I'm not asking you to play stock market, but does that make Ford at their valuation and GM at their valuation just a screaming buy, whether or not you're in it or not?
Yeah, we're not in those. They're not of interest to us that much. What is interest to us are the component suppliers, the companies like Schaeffler in Germany, which is trading at a 5% dividend yield, very good balance sheet, and they make $17 billion in sales, $2.5 billion in EBITDA, and can buy it at 4 times EBITDA. And it's one of the most innovative companies in Germany. They just won the E-Formula One circuit here in Brooklyn. You might have seen that. It's very exciting. Yeah. But from our perspective, having been at this for 30 years, we're seeing some of the most compelling risk rewards in our universe of longs at this moment.
I want to get to Huntsman, because that was your best idea here at Delivering Alpha. You're
right.
Long Huntsman.
Yes.
You like it. It's a very cyclical company, but you see a lot of cash generation.
Well, we take issue with the cyclical nature. It is trading as if it is very cyclical. It's become a lot less cyclical with the transformation it's gone through and spinning out its most cyclical elements. So it's a very undervalued, attractive situation.
The TiO2 business is what you're talking about, divesting the TiO2.
Yeah, they divested the titanium dioxide business called Venator. Mm-hmm. And with that, they are now basically into differentiated chemicals at a very low valuation.
You're giving it 3% today based on your...
Based on your speech out front, my question to you, rising input costs, are they any concern? Do they even factor into this equation?
They're always a concern. We look through it on every business segment with the management, but it is all manageable.
All right.
Hey there, thanks for checking out CNBC on YouTube. Be sure to subscribe to stay up to date on all of the day's biggest stories. You can also click on any of the videos around me to watch the latest from CNBC. Thanks for watching.